some of the history of this St. Martin's University and St. Martin's High School, St. Martin's Abbey in our past. I always worry a little bit about somehow recalling the past. You hear sometimes people, the older they get, the more they keep thinking about the past as kind of the golden age. Well, certainly it was not necessarily a golden age in the past, as you will probably discover in my brief comments. First of all, I think in some ways it all sort of started when there was a large German, Catholic German community that settled in the Tacoma area. And I'm not sure what drew them there at that time. I think probably employment of some sort. But the Bishop of Nisqually, today we refer to the Bishop as the Bishop of Seattle, but Nisqually was sort of the seat of the Archdiocese at that time. And he realized that he had a large Catholic German community in the Tacoma area, and he needed German-speaking, he needed German-speaking priests to minister to this Catholic community. And so what he did is that he wrote to the abbot at St. John's in Cowlesville, Minnesota, and because that was a large German community itself, and asked if he had any priests that could come out here to minister to this German community in Tacoma, Washington. And so, lo and behold, the abbot did indeed send out, I think, four or five priests to minister to those Catholics, German Catholics in Tacoma. And apparently, they had their first, they first opened up their church, their chapel, at a storefront on 54th and Warner Street in Tacoma. I'm not familiar with Tacoma, but it's somewhere around downtown Tacoma. And then when the community enlarged, they then moved to the Odd Fellows Hall in Tacoma, and that's where they used to celebrate the Sunday Mass. Well, things went so well that the bishop said, well, I wonder if there's any more St. John's monks we could come out here to open up a school. And basically, that's how St. Martin's began. And so the first thing they did when they came out is they were looking for a place to establish this Catholic school. And I think they were somewhat uncertain as to whether they wanted, I think the bishop wanted both a grammar school, a high school, and then eventually Nisqually Hill. And when you go down to the Nisqually Valley, I don't know if you've ever noticed, off there's this high hill, and you can see some white farm buildings up there. Well, that was the first place that they looked at, and then for some reason that sort of fell through. The other place that was for sale was Hicks Lake, I think the entire lake, and there was some misfortunate sort of drownings at St. John's at the lake they had there. And they said, this is not a good place to open up a school. Our students would be falling into the lake and have problems. So somebody suggested in Woodland, Washington, which this area was called at that time, Woodland, Washington, there was 600 acres that was available. And so the good thing about this particular property was that it was on a hill. And it's traditional that Benedictines, story of Moses going to the mountaintop, and the same thing with Jesus going to the mountain with his disciples. And the good thing about this property was that there was a railroad track that just ran at the foot of it, and this would be perfect for our students to come from Tacoma, Seattle, from Portland, ideal. They couldn't be happier. So they bought the property for $6,240. All 600 acres. It was basically all wooded. And so they got here, they were delighted with themselves, and then they realized that the railroad track, which the tracks are still available down at the bottom of the hill in the front, was a freight train track. And so that put an end to bringing students in from north and west and south and east and so. So anyway, the school opened, and the first thing they built was this wooden structure here, as you can see in the picture. There it is here on the screen. And what was interesting about this is that the monks lived in there, as well as the, I think they had grammars, high school students, and then the few college students that came, and they also had the classrooms in there. So when they opened the college, only one student showed up. And that was Angus MacDonald from Shelton. And what was interesting about that is that they carried on just as if they would have had 200 students. They had regular classes for him. They had PE activity for him, the one student. And then I think shortly before Christmas, a few others came. And then I think the second semester they had something like 15 or 20 students that enrolled. So, and what they offered at that time for the college was essentially a commercial certificate. And then I think some 2 years later, they had a total of 29 students, which was pretty good at that time. Then the high school, once the high school was added to the college, they needed a larger structure. And so what they did is they cut down practically all of the trees, as you can see there. Most of the trees came down, and they used the money from the sale of the trees to build the front wing. That, as we know, that should come up the front. That wing was covered with the sale of the trees. And then they added the longer wing after that. And I think that that was built about 1914 or so. During the war years, especially World War I, many of the students enlisted, and so we lost a lot of our students, and there were very few here left. And so what happened is that many of the monks, I think about seven or eight of them, enrolled in the military as chaplains, and actually two of our monks, Father Marcel and Father Robert, were actually prisoners of war. And I can remember years later when I was living next door to Father Marcel in the monastery, and he was very elderly at the time, I used to try to get him to talk about those years that he was a prisoner of war, but he was very hesitant. Oh, there he is. Yeah, very hesitant to talk about them at that time, unfortunately. But for whatever reasons he had, the few monks that were left without any teaching ability, Lambert Burton, sent most of them on to earn PhDs. And what was interesting about this was that the college would have otherwise folded at this point, because there were basically very few students, we had hardly any faculty at all. But the high school literally kept the college alive because of the income that we received from the high school, it was able to support the college as well. There were some blessings, believe it or not, to the war years. We received an amazing amount of war surplus, particularly from Fort Lewis and McCord Airfield. The what we call the trailers or the Quonset huts, there were seven or eight of them that we received, plus all the bunk beds, the blankets, the bedding, all of the laundry equipment, mangles, steam irons, large walk-in freezers for the kitchen, the Abbey Theater, the sawmill, all of that came from war surplus from Fort Lewis and McCord. So it really helped us a lot in terms of being able to continue on some of the things that we would otherwise have to pay large sums for. But the Quonset huts, were, I think there were seven of them, and they were all lettered A, B, C, D, and F. Anselm, Bennett, Columban, Dunstan, Eberhardt, and Francis Hall. And most of the halls, particularly Anselm and Bennett and Francis, is where the students lived. There were just room for one bunk bed and two desks. That was about the size of the rooms. They're very small. They're basically army barracks. And then at the end of the hall was one shower. And so you can imagine the sort of the activity getting to the shower before somebody else. The Columban Hall was used as a bookstore and a soda fountain. So we had a soda fountain. Brother Hugh was the manager of that for years and years. And then there was then Eberhardt Hall was a place where the students would gather at night to play ping pong and play cards, that sort of thing. So all of the activity was held down there. The place is actually where the Marcus Pavilion is located. That's the area of all that took place. The Benedictine sisters from Cottonwood, Idaho, did the cooking and sewing for students and for the monks from 1904 to 1959, some 45 years. And we had on the farm at that time I think close to 2,000 chickens. We had 250 pigs. We had 60 milking cows, large vegetable gardens. We used to make our own sauerkraut and our own cheese. We had a large cheese factory. And Brother Adam was the one who had the beehive, so we had lots and lots of honey on campus. But I remember I think it was during my novitiate, I was assigned to the brother who made the sauerkraut. He was one of the Bavarian. We had a large number of Bavarian brothers who were here on the campus. And so I remember one hot late summer day, the novice master, Father Clement, asked me to work with brother and learn how to make sauerkraut. That was the big item here. So I can remember he was sitting on a stool, and he had a huge, probably a 25 or 40 gallon barrel. And he had a big, somehow a kind of a big stick, and he was making the sauerkraut. And it was so hot that he was perspiring. And then the thing that got me, when his nose started running, I went right down to the public platform that says, "That's it. I'm not working with this anymore. I'm never touching sauerkraut again." And he said, Brother Killian, go back up there and work with brother and quit being so persnickety, because you're not going to make it as a monk." So anyway, I went back up and I helped with making of the sauerkraut. We also had, I think especially during the summer months, but we didn't have any students on campus, we had so much leftover milk that we hired a cheesemaker, a top-notch cheesemaker. And I remember we turned what was now the guest dining room, it's right across from the monastic dining room, plus one of the food services offices, and we turned it into a cheese store. And we built large shelves, and I can still see them so clearly. We had these huge wheels about that. I mean, they're absolutely huge, wrapped in wax. And it was top-notch cheese. I mean, you'd go over to Fred Meyer's or to Safeway, you'd pay probably for a little piece of that same cheese, something like $9, $10, $15. It was really top-notch. But in those days, we didn't appreciate sharp cheese or smelly cheese. Just wasn't, I mean, Velveeta was the top of the line. So I remember we only had, I think, about three or four lay members who were teaching the faculty. And what we used to give them at Christmas for Christmas presents was the large wheel of cheese plus a jug of the wine, the mass wine. Father Neil and I used to fill those big jugs on Saturday afternoons with the wine. And so at Christmas came, we had a little party downstairs for the five or six lay faculty, and we hand them the big wheel of cheese and the jug of wine, and you can still, I can still see them rolling their eyes. No, not another wheel of this cheese, and whatever they took with it, but that's how we got rid of it. But anyway, the cheese was there for years on those shelves. And even to this day, when I go into the guest dining room, I can still slightly smell that very strong, strong cheese that we had there. So, one of the brother who used to make he had the beehives, and the beehives would be located down, if you walk down past that large field, past the cemetery, keep going straight on the old farm road, he had a bee house there, and you could see him there every day with his big hat and the net and all the stuff that he did with the bees. But he was also a bit of a character. He had he had about 125 clocks in his room, and he had most of the clocks were set to certain locations in the world, and I don't know how he ever slept at night with the ticking of the clocks. But he also had a strange habit of he had this thing about the moon. He used to walk out at night in the nude around the at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning in order to get the rays from the moon on him. And so finally, I think at some point, the abbot had to sort of lock him wandering around. So the Benedictine sisters were called back to St. Gertrude's. And what happened at that point is that we thought that we could continue with the farm. But unfortunately, when we brought in the food services, the new services, they were not interested in the farm supplies because it was much easier getting frozen food or getting stuff already prepared. And so we had to do something with the farm. So we ended up having to put to death the 2,000 chickens, and I think we slaughtered most of the pigs and sold a lot of them. The cows were sold, and so the farm basically came to an end. But what was interesting, as a result of that, the chicken coops became the haunted houses for the college students. So every Halloween, we had the best haunted houses in Thurston County. People came from all over to come to St. Martin's to celebrate the haunted houses. And the students were so, I can still see that we had, I think, about 7 or 8 long chicken houses that went from that wall, probably the very back room there. And they became sort of passageways for people to travel from one place to the next. And they had all kinds of imaginary things, scary things for students and for people came from all over. I remember at that time, one of my nephews, who I think was only about 5 or 6 years old, I took him through there, and he freaked out about halfway through, and yelling at me, he was so terrified. So my sister was very unhappy to see the haunted house. But the barns eventually the barns became stables for a lot of our students who brought their horses on the campus, and and that was a hugely successful sort of adventure. I think we had up to about 17 horses on the campus at that time, and all of the trails that you see that the cross country students are running on were the old bridle paths that we made, and you could actually ride on the campus for almost 2 hours without ever repeating yourself. You know, it was just a really wonderful. It was a great period time we had there. What was also interesting about the new food service that we had, once the sisters had departed, The first food service that we hired was called the Prophet Service, P-R-O-P-H-E-T, Prophet Service. And the first night, we were all excited. They had a very special dinner they had prepared for us. And what was it but the frog's legs? Now, serving monks frog's legs was not the best first meal. We didn't know what the heck it was, we quickly got away. So that didn't go. But anyway, the next morning, the cook made off with all the money from the till and disappeared. I don't think he ever caught him. So that food service didn't last very long. And then I think we had several other food services, but I think Saga was the one that lasted the longest. But the one of the food service managers also had a business on the side, and he was when he would order the food for the university, for the college, he'd also order a supply for himself that he had, which he was selling at command. That went on for about 2 years until somebody finally caught him. But so I think we're okay with Bon Appetit. When Father Michael became president, he established the Board of Regents. And I think the Board of Regents is before the Board of Trustees, I forget exactly if we had the Board of Trustees and also the Board of Regents at the same time. But what I can remember is that it was about that time that the monks, I happened to have been on the board at that time, and I think there was about 9 or 10 monks on it. There weren't any lay people on the board. And so we decided finally, after a struggle, to open up our doors to women students. And that's because I think two of our lay faculty members had daughters that were of college age. And so there was a lot of debate about it. And so finally, we decided, took the vote that we would open the doors for women students. And this was about 1965, 66, I think. The funny thing about that, I remember that afternoon we were discussing it, and finally the vote was taken, and we decided we'd open for women students. But then suddenly one of the monks raised the issue, and we decided they would live in Barron Hall. We would give them the bottom wing of Barron Hall, and then we would sort of barricade the top two so they wouldn't think of going up there, or the guys wouldn't come down. But one of the big issues was I remember what Father John Raymond, he said, we've got a problem here. What are we going to do about the urinals, which was the men's bathroom? And, oh my gosh, that's right. How can we hide the urinals? Well, can we pull them out so they won't see them? So one of the monks said, let's do this. We'll turn them into planters. That's exactly what we did. We put potted plants, and we put all kinds of things, just so the poor women students would not be shocked to see the animals. And then somebody said, and this is really great because all they need to do is just sort of flush it with the water of the plant. Great idea. So we were quite pleased with ourselves over that. There's several little issues about the women students we opened up. We also had just built Burton Hall at that time. And if you're familiar with Burton, we moved the women students from Barron over to Burton, and then we put up what's known as louvers. Do you know what a louver is? They were basically fences that blocked off so others from Burton Hall couldn't see in through the windows for the women students. And then we had a locked door, and the women had to be inside their wing. That is to no later than 10 o'clock, the doors were locked. But I used to hear from several of the women students that tell you how they used to climb climb the louvers and get over the top of them if they came in late. But we also had a regulation that on Sunday night, the students had to dress up. The male students had to have ties, and the women students had to have either a suit or a dress skirt. There were no trousers allowed whatsoever. And I always remember this. I was dean of students at the time. I was in charge of not allowing any student into the dining hall without a tie, or the women had to have dresses and skirts on. So I can remember sort of booting out several of the male students because they didn't have ties, and they would get upset and then go down and put a tie on and come back. So the next Sunday, believe it or not, they're watching to be sure they had their tie on. In comes all of the male students, every last one of them, and all they had was a tie. Many of them had bathing suits, just a tie, a pair of shorts, just a tie. And then, brother, you said we had to have a tie, we got our ties on. And I thought at that point, that's it.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna fight this any longer. So they could wear whatever they wanted to. But then he also hired a wonderful woman, Mrs. Elda Brophy, as Dean of Women. And she was our first Dean of Women. And we didn't have any more than maybe 25 or 26 women on campus. But one of the regulations is that women students were not allowed to wear trousers, or because in those days, jeans were sort of totally forbidden, but trousers to classes. They had to have skirts and dresses. So several of the women students came to me and said, listen, why do we have to wear dresses? It's uncomfortable, it's cold in the winter. Why can't we wear our jeans or trousers? So I went to the Dean of Women, and she says, well, I hate to get into this. So after several weeks of arguing with the students back and forth, she decided to give in. So I remember she called me and she says, now, brother, what I want you to do is inform the students they can wear trousers, slacks, the women's students, but they have to move properly. I said, what the heck does she mean by that? So I went down and I said to the student, you can wear trousers, but they have to move. So use your imagination. I'm still not quite sure what she said. They have to move properly. One of the sad things about closing the high school in 1974 was that there were essentially 16 monks that were left without work. And I think when they took the vote to close, they took it at the summer retreat. And there's all kinds of controversy about how that worked out and what should have been done and whatnot. But I think so many of the high school student faculty had to go back to the resident halls to look after the students. So the vote was taken mostly by the college faculty, and they voted to close the high school. So it was, I never worked in the high school myself, but I know there was a lot of bitterness about that and a lot of sadness because so many of those 16 monks were without work. And I think of the abbot at that time said, well, just find yourselves a job. Many of them went out to parishes. Many of them went to hospital as chaplains. Many of them went to California to teach in high schools. And there are very, very few. I think maybe only one or two actually came to the college to work. And that was a bit unfortunate. And even to this day, there's a bit of sort of unhappiness about all of that. Something I wanted to mention to you, you'll notice, when we had the haunted houses, and also the cemetery was a great place to hang out, especially around Halloween. Mm-hmm. And what happened, so oftentimes there's a couple of things that have happened, but when the at Halloween, one of the, I forget what it's called, but it's this kind of a snipe hike, something you go looking for something, and we had all kinds of detailed directions of how to get there. But anyway, you'd end up at the cemetery, and so some of the students would dress up either in sort of monk's clothes or white sheets over their body, and as they're coming in looking to find this hidden object, they would come out from behind the wall and terrify the, oh, thank you very much. Yeah, and would terrify the visitors. And I think also some of the guys would bring their girlfriends down to the cemetery just to show them the campus, and they had planted their fellow students, again, with white sheets to pop out from behind them. And of course, it was one way of sort of frightening. I don't know why we think this is funny. But you'll also notice on that sheet I gave you of the cemetery, the one that has the, you'll notice the two angels on the top of the pillars. Well, that's the way it was originally designed, as you see it on that map. But unfortunately, some vandals came out there one night, and they were actually shooting at those angels, and they basically destroyed the two Plaster of Paris angels they had up there. And so that's when Brother Bruno made those new gates, if you remember seeing them. And then the medal comes from the medal of the angel Gabriel and the angel Raphael. So anyway, kind of to wrap things up a little bit, Dr. Spangler, as you probably already know, served as president of St. Martin's University for some 24 years, and he really brought a strong degree of stability and a sense of well-being amongst the faculty and the staff and the students. He was a wonderful presence at that time. And then after his retirement, and then I think he went, he retired, and he came back again for another period to serve. But he was a wonderful, wonderful president. And I think one of the reasons why we're so stable today is because of his presence and his selection of really good board members that were really interested in St. Martin's and wanted to stabilize the university. Then, of course, Dr. Hendricks has been a marvelous builder of the campus. I think all of the new buildings that we have and the progress we're making really comes under Dr. Hendricks, and that's been a real blessing for us in so many, many ways. So there's really lots more stories I could tell you, but I thought maybe if you just pause for a moment, if you might have some questions, I'd be really happy to answer any questions you have about anything of the past or anything done. That's right. The image that you have of the with the church, that's one of the sheets I gave you. You'll notice the church at the center, the two-tiered church on your sheets that I gave you. There you go. That was the church that was designed to sit at the top of the hill, basically just about where we are here, facing out toward the mountain. That's where that would be. And then there was another wing that was intended to be added. You can see behind the church on the image there, that was the other wing that would have gone out from that end, and that never got built. To go back to the group, the Catholic community in Tacoma, as they started to grow and as they moved out of the storefront to the Odd Fellows Hall, they were ready to build their own church. And so what we did is that we gave them, because they were the same members of our community, they're our same monks, we gave them the blueprints and all of the interior furnishings that we had. And that is the same church that stands right next to the Tacoma Dome. Except they ran out of money, and they only were able to build one tower. So when you drive by, you'll see that church with the one tower. That should have been standing here on top of the hill. And if you've ever been into it's Holy Rosary Church. If you've ever been to Holy Rosary, it's really magnificent. It's a beautiful, beautiful church. Very Gothic in its style. And but I love the Abbey Church, and that's been a real blessing, I think, for us. And what's interesting about the Abbey Church is that it's when the monks, we lost this church, Abbot Rayfield started designing other churches. And one of the churches that he had in mind was a big concrete steel, sort of marble church that somehow didn't look right here in the Pacific Northwest. So a group of monks got together, and they also got together with one of the students of Frank Lloyd Wright. And as you know, Frank Lloyd Wright is the great American architect. And Frank Lloyd Wright said that every building should belong to the place like a plant. And if it doesn't, it's not gonna work, it's not gonna fit. And Abbot Rayfield's two or three designs for a new Abbey church, once that was gone, didn't belong here. They would probably would do well in the middle of Manhattan or middle of Chicago, but it didn't belong here. So these monks got together and they basically designed this Abbey church that we have. And you'll notice when you walk in there, it really does belong here with its wood and its gravel aggregate and the colors and what have you. It's very much a Pacific Northwest church. So we're really blessed to have that church.
Can you talk about, I know the stained glass windows in the Abbey Church, where they came from?
Oh, yes. You notice the stained glass windows in various aspects of the church. Well, we were planning the church, it was about the time that the Seattle World's Fair was just wrapping up. And I can remember President Kennedy was supposed to come out to close the fair, but because of the Cuban Missile Crisis, he was not able to come out. And so the Vatican Pavilion had a wonderful, brilliant exhibition at the Seattle World's Fair. And they called us and said, we have all of this stained glass that we're not gonna haul back to Italy. And I think some of it was actually Tiffany glass. So could you guys use it? So myself and a group of the monks drove up with this huge, huge pickup, and we loaded all that stained glass, and we brought it back, and we loaded it into one of the old barns that we still had at the farm. And in constructing the Abbey Church, we used a lot. So all of that glass that you see there is actually from the Seattle World's Fair Vatican exhibition. And we also put a lot of it into Baron Hall, when we built Baron Hall, especially along the stairwells. But I noticed, I was down there not too long ago, I noticed that that they have it filled in, and I think a lot of the glass was either knocked out or kicked out. So you don't notice it. But we used a lot of it in the monastery. If you come to the monastery, you can see through all the rooms we have all of that stained glass used. Brother Bruno Leverdier was the artist, and he designed the 72 chapters of the Rule of St. Benedict are depicted in the monastery. Unfortunately, you can see some of them, but you can't go beyond a certain period because the place is cloistered. And we use that pretty well. So thanks for reminding me about that.
How about the doors that are carved?
Oh, the front doors. They were one of the decisions that we made in building the Abbey Church, that we decided that we would not, as so many churches did, we would not go to Rome or to Italy to get all of our, the statues and all of the sort of interior. And we decided that we'd use local artists for whatever artwork we were going to use in the Abbey Church. And the doors were done by a local artist. And Sister Gertrude might remember this, but he was hired by St. John's in Collegeville, Minnesota. And so he was halfway through working on the doors, and he got called back to St. John's, or he got hired by St. John's. So he hauled the doors back with him, and he finished them back there. But what's interesting about the doors is that you'll notice in all the little sort of squares and the blocks, there is various stories about many of them coming from the book of Genesis. And there's just some wonderful stories and images on there. The artist also used the Washington State fruit, the apple, plus the rhododendron, the Washington State flower, and the Washington State bird are also depicted on there as well. And one of my favorite images is the image of Saint Boniface, whose feast day was Monday. It was the patron of Germany, I think. And one of the images you see, and he's also the patron of, I think, a European Benedictine, if I'm not mistaken. But you see, there's this great big oak tree, and you see St. Boniface chopping the tree down. Then you have these figures, people sort of horrified. Well, the story is that St. Boniface went into the village, and these people were worshiping this tree, and they felt there was evil spirits there, and they had to worship the tree. And so he was showing them that this is a lot of nonsense. So you see him chopping the tree down, and all of the villagers sort of horrified. But you'll see that on that image. But there's all just wonderful, wonderful stories on there. And you also could also see images of the gargoyles, these sort of ugly little faces in metal. And that is to sort of scare away any bad spirits from coming into the church. And the doors are wonderful. They're a wonderful gift to us as well. The banners in the church are obviously done by Brother Seth, and also the glass doors that you see there. Should I tell the story about Brother Seth's?
We're intrigued.
Sure.
Well, you can cut this out, it's not a problem. Seth is a wonderful, wonderful artist, he was working on, when we closed the farm, he took the old slaughterhouse and he turned it into an art studio. He did all of his work there. And you can even see in some of on the glass doors, these appear to be angel wings. They're actually the feathers from the slaughtered chickens that we had killed. And he just basically sketched into his art, into his pieces, the wings of the chicken, but they look like angel wings on the doors. But at that point, he and the rabbit at that time were sort of at odds with each other. He wanted him to be doing something much more practical, like turning out little cups with Bud Benedictine monks on them to sell for $2.95 a piece, maybe 10,000 of those and different things. So he wasn't interested. So finally, they came to a breaking point where they were not going to, so anyway, he decided to leave. And he hadn't quite finished the doors yet. So Edward said, now when you finish the doors, he says, just sign your initials and we'll get them mounted and put in. And so he finished them, and then after he left, they were mounted and they're in there. So those doors actually open and close. They're really beautiful doors, glass doors. And what he did is that I forget the process that he used, but I remember him seeing down there at the slaughterhouse working on these glass doors, and I think the gray area is from the acid that he drops on the doors, and he used images of our students on the doors as well. Some of the Adam figure is one of our basketball players, but it was something like 10, 15 years later. There was a woman in the Blessed Sacrament Chapel praying, and all of a sudden, she noticed something on the door. She was horrified. She went down to the abbot's office, and she says, there's a picture of a nude man on the door. She said, that's so inappropriate, especially in the Blessed Sacrament Chapel. So the abbot came in, what the heck is she talking about? And lo and behold, Seth took a picture of himself. That was his signature, and I oftentimes thought that was the way he was getting back at For a lot of things to do, crack plates. So. And what can you can't, you can't erase it, you can't cut it out.
But we all want to go see the door.
Yes. Yeah.
Robin wants to go see the door. Robin wants to go see the door.
It's the second door.
We'll be there. So, Father Killian, I heard that the brick from this building came from Seattle after the fire, and that the monks also went there and brought bricks back to build Old Main. Is that true?
No, I'm not sure about the brick in this building itself. All I can tell you about this brick is that it was so well done that when we had that earthquake in 1963, I remember some engineering students down at the old engineering lab said they literally saw this building, this wing here, swaying some 10 feet this way, 10 feet this way, if you can imagine. And I remember I was up in my office, and it was sort of terrifying. But the stone masons that came out here and to examine the building said that this brick was so perfectly constructed and built that that's what kept the building up, the brick. But the brick that you see around, for example, around on the cemetery pathway, and as you come up around the hill, you can see the sort of the brick around there. All of that came from the sisters' house, which was a brick Victorian mansion. So the sisters lived, and that was really where the present church is standing. So unfortunately, and we used that as a kind of a minor seminary for a while, and after the sisters left in 1965 or so. And so it was kind of sad to knock that building. It was a beautiful building. It'd make a great English department or humanities division or something. But anyway, we used a lot of the brick. So anytime you see any brick around other than this building, it comes from the sisters' house. But I don't know much about the history of where this brick came from. But I can certainly check that out. Any other questions you might have about our past history?
I have one. I heard that our organ had to be flown in. Is that true, or helicoptered in?
Would you say that once again, please?
I heard that the organ had to be brought in by a helicopter. Is that true?
In the Abbey Church?
The organ in the Abbey?
The organ in the Abbey Church.
Oh, yeah.
How did it get delivered? Was
Yes, I'm sorry, that's my, it's not you, it's my hearing. It's called a tracker organ. And when we were in the process of, you know, building this Frank Lloyd Wright church, if you may call it that, it's not quite Frank Lloyd Wright, but Father George happened to have been studying in Rome at that time. And he was, one of his classmates was from either from Denmark or Sweden, I'm not quite certain, but the young man's family was in the organ building business, and so George went to visit and talked to them about possibly building this organ. So the St. Martin's organ, it was the very first tracker organ that was entered, that came into this country from that family. And I remember I was in school in London at the time I came home for the summer. I'll never forget walking into the church, and the roof was on and the sides were up, but nothing else was in the church. But I saw this this man and three of his sons. They had the organ all laid out on the floor, and they literally carried that organ over by boat, you know, piece by piece, and then somehow got it shipped from the docks here to the Abbey. They basically built the tracker organ. But since that was in, there were a lot of musically talented people that were building churches that came here to look at this. And I think there may have been a few other churches that also contacted this family of organ builders. Mm-hmm. So that's what the Abbey Church. It's called the tracker. I didn't know the first thing about it. But somebody told me that It's this, the church, the Abbey organ would be the same type of organ that, say, Johann Sebastian Bach might have played, except ours is electrical. All you need to do is turn the key on, and that pumps the air up into the pipes. But during Bach's day, they had these billows, and the story goes he used to haul in these little urchin kids off the streets to walk on the billows to pump the air up. And the story was that he had a big jug of beer next to the organ, so when the kids would start getting tired, he'd give them beer, keep them going, so he could play for mass or for a concert he might have had. But luckily, we have the electricity today. So, any other questions you might have?
How long have you been here?
I came in 1952. And my family, my mother and father are from Ireland, and so after they married, they came into New York City, and all of my siblings were born in New York, and myself. And my mother had seven sisters, and the first one went from New York, from Ireland to New York, and from New York to Squim, Washington. The next one came from Ireland to New York, Squim, Washington. And so my mother was the youngest of the seven sisters, and so out we came. I think the first Sunday we went to the, we moved to Port Angeles, and the first Sunday my father asked, he heard the priest ask him if he had where the local Catholic high school was, thinking that there'd be a Catholic high school in every other block. He said, well, the closest is St. Martin's. It's 140 miles south of here. Send it down there. So I was the oldest in the family. So I used to hitchhike from Port Angeles to Lacey here to come to school. And then every week, get a weekend off on every month. Then I'd get back out on the old I-5 and I'd stick my thumb out and I'd get a ride logging trucks. I did that for years and years, hitchhike. I can remember the years that hitchhiking was forbidden in the state, and so it was a real challenge to keep my eye out for police cars and not to stick my thumb out. So I did that. And I guess hitchhiking isn't a big thing these days. I mentioned to the students, oh, do you hitchhike? I did. So it was very common. I actually hitchhiked from here to Washington, D.C., and then I hitchhiked from Washington, D.C. to Los Angeles, and I was out there. So I used to love hitchhiking. It was a real cheap way to travel.
So Abbot Neil told me a story about a horse named Satan.
That the horse?
And it bit you. The horse bit you. And his name was Satan.
Yeah.
And he has a joke. Do you want to tell about that?
Why was he telling you that story?
To embarrass you.
We had the horses. I was basically in charge of the horses. I think we had about 15 of them at that time. And we had just received a beautiful Egyptian Arab, wonderful, really, sort of high-strung horse that was given to us because I was working on the weekends up at Eatonville, the parish. And so I was given the horse as a kind of a gift. And so we had, what the heck? So he was a little difficult to ride, but he was so high-spirited and dominating the other horses. So there's some former students came to campus and said, let's take a walk down to the farm. I'll show you guys some, you know, the horses. And so I picked up from the old apple trees, I picked up a bag of apples and brought them down. So we're standing at the fence, and I was cutting the apples in half and giving the various horses coming up for a bite of the apple. And this particular horse, whose name was Vatican, came up that he was sort of biting the other horses, and so I snapped him on the nose to have him go away. And the first thing he did, he bit me. I had just a t-shirt on. He bit me, literally.
Ow.
right here, and I still have the scars that I'm not going to show you. But he drew blood.
Oh,
it was. I remember it was an agony. Ah! I sort of slapped him, and he let go finally. But when I went up and word got back to Abbot Conrad, who was Abbot at the time, he said that was a sign. See, Vatican was his name, and you're being punished for your radical ideas about the church. And so that was his response to it. And somehow, Vatican bit me. Some punishment on me for my radical theology. That was that story. Yeah, we used to have, when we had all, these were all mass chapels, but where you are right now, there must have been about 25 or 30 mass chapels all along here. And one of the things that we had to do is every priest had to say his own separate mass every morning. And so I remember we used to hope that a priest who said a fast mass would get to celebrate to serve his mass, and not one of the slow ones. But one of the jobs that Abbot Neil was assigned to was to fill the gallon jugs with wine. And because we used to get the wine in these gigantic barrels, these wooden barrels, from California, from some wine company. And so we used to stick the rubber tubes, Neil would stick the rubber tubes into it, and into the, you had a cycler. And so he was the only one that was trusted with the wine cellar. And so I was out mowing the lawns, and so we had about 15 or 20 minutes where we had to get ready for choir, evening prayer. So I gave a signal on the door, up, 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 and then he let me in, and we would have a sip of wine. So, but I remember he was behind, and he asked me to help, and so in cycling, I probably drank too much. I had to go out and put the lawnmower away. And the monks were coming over because we used to have our chapel in the old laundry building. So I hopped on the Toro lawnmower. I pulled up the wings, and I went too fast. The thing is, I crashed into the apple tree, turned the lawnmower over, and there I was spread out, half snuggered, as the monks were all walking by. He reminds me about that.
Oh.
I blame you for letting me into the
Well,
so, yeah, there's lots of crazy, yeah. Yeah, we used to have to do the dishes at night, all the student dishes and the faculty dishes. And so when we finished the dishes, we used to somehow get a key to the supply room where they had big bags of walnuts and chocolate chips and all kinds of supplies. So when we would finish, we would go in and, you know, have some treats for ourselves. And so I remember one night we went in there, and all of a sudden we heard the door opening, which we locked it. It was one of the sisters coming in, and we were hiding down behind the sacks. And she picked up whatever she was getting, and as she went out the door, she said, "Brother Neil and Brother Killian, you can come out now." She walked out, closed the door. So she was nice about it. So, any other questions about that?
Someone online asked about the Greek organizations and how they helped the school.
The fraternities?
Greek, yeah, I think so, yeah.
I forget when we first, Sigma Mu Kappa, when I was a student, I was also a member of Sigma Mu Kappa. It was the men's fraternity. And that fraternity was basically those who did service projects that helped out with, remember one time we went to the Nisqually Valley to help, there was a flooding, the Nisqually River. We did a lot of different things, volunteered here and volunteered there. And And then as time went on, I think during the 60s, it became more of a social fraternity. And then about that time, there was a lot of drinking that could be able to dream of drinking at members of the fraternity back in the 1950s. And then I think Alpha became one of the fraternities, the second, but kind of because Sigma was too wild and too many parties and have you. And then the women's sorority started. I think they actually founded two sororities. I forget the names of them right now. And one was wild and one was more service oriented. And so I think at some point, Melanie, God bless her, decided that there was just too much danger in fraternities and sororities, and so I think they were banned from the campus. And it's still today I hear from members of the fraternity, because I was a member of the Sigma fraternity, they'd come back, why don't we have the fraternities? What happened to Sigma? Why can't we get that started back? At one point, I actually took some of the students to Roy, the first day he became president, trying to get him to institute the fraternities again. But he said, let me think about it. He's still thinking about it. I think they just went by the wayside. Sorry, Genevieve.
Oh, there was another question online about the old gym fire. Do you remember the old gym? Was the old gym ever on fire? Or
gym.
Old gym.
The old gym. Gymnasium.
Was it ever on fire?
The old gym?
A fire in the gym.
What happened was when we built the new gym, the old gym served as a theater, that's where we had all of our basketball games, that's where we had our PE exercises, that's where we had the dances on Saturday nights. It was a great place, both for the high school and the college people used it. And the upstairs, I don't think there's a picture, but the upstairs of the gym was it was actually a movie theater. It was really wonderful. But the only way you can get to it is to go up the back behind the gym. It was this huge, I mean, you have to really be well coordinated to get up there. That's where we had the movies on the old, the old wheel. I forget what it was called, so finally when we built the gym, Marcus Pavilion, and when the high school closed, we decided that we were not using it any longer, and we wanted to, it was just not being used. So we decided we were going to actually sort of just tear it down. But some man came to us and said, if you give me the lumber, the lumber is very valuable, and it's very seasoned. You know, you can imagine all those years. Fine. So he would take it down, and then he could sell the lumber and benefit from the profits. Well, I'll never forget one night I was getting ready for bed, and I'm on that side of the mountainside of the monastery, and all of a sudden I'd gotten to bed, and my curtains were closed, and all of a sudden the room lit up. I said, what? I thought I was having a vision. I opened the door and it was dark outside, and so I pulled my drapes and I looked down and I saw the gym. It was a mass of flames. The whole thing was just a red ball. And I can remember hearing from students happened to have been in that evening in Olympia. They could literally see the light. It was so. And if you think about it, the floors were so seasoned with oil, year after year, oiling the floor and cleaning the floor. The place just exploded. And so we were feeling so sorry for that poor man. Because he lost everything. All this lumber he was going to sell. And so lo and behold, somebody located an oil can out behind the woods that we had thrown out there, and they traced it back to him. He wanted to get the insurance money for that.
Yeah.
And he set the place on fire himself. It was a lot easier than tearing that building down. So that's what happened there. Yeah, it was. I think we went to jail.
Father Killian, were you here when the imposter came? He was the guy that pretended to be a monk and
pretended
to be a teacher.
Joe,
and he got arrested, right?
Lepar. French name, Joe Lepar. Well, I remember Abbot Conrad called a meeting. He said, I met this candidate. He's sort of, he was in his kind of middle 30s. Like, usually, at those days, we were getting young candidates in 18, 19, 20. This guy's a little bit older. And he said he has a doctorate, a PhD in literature. He's also a medical doctor, and he is also the psychiatric head doctor at the Dallas, Texas hospital, the big hospital in Dallas. This is fantastic. We're just great. So, at the time, he was in Rome giving a paper, and so he came back, and he stopped on his way back, and he spent about a week with us. Very, very nice fellow. And I became particularly friendly with him because he raised Arabian horses in Texas. He had this huge ranch. I think it's about a 6,000 acre ranch, but he raised these wonderful Arabian horses. I would just so. And so he would come down when I would feed the horses, or I'd go down to let them out into another field. He always came along with me. And so this went on to then he left, but he came back again. And he was always asking how the horses were doing. And I said, fine. So I remember, he was a medical doctor, he was also issuing prescriptions to students. He had a little office over here.
Oh, my dear.
And he would examine them if they had sore throats or something. So he was, in some ways, really our first nursing station. So he, he was so good about things. But so one evening he came up and he says, I was just down checking the horses, and somebody is actually burning the horses. I said, what are you talking about? So I ran down to the stables, and sure enough, several of the horses had, like, if you got that blowtorch and you just burnt behind them with the horses. And they were all nervous, and I thought, oh my God. He said, there's probably somebody in the area that's an idea of people, you hear about people damaging animals or hurting animals, and just terrible thing. I was so upset about that. And so, I called the vet immediately and had the vet treat the hind rumps of the horses. I needed to get going and get some feed at the local feed place over here in Lacey. And so I said, would you mind just driving me in? I couldn't get a car, there weren't any cars available. I need to get some oats and some bran for the horses. He said, sure. So anyway, we drove in, and I got, I think, a 10-pound bag of this, 10-pound bag of that. And I was short, $6, I remember it. And I said, Joe, could you loan me the $6? I don't care. And he hesitated. Well, as long as you get it back to me. I said, oh, yeah, absolutely. So anyhow, time went on, and he was also sort of working down on the farm. And so I went down, and I said, well, let's go out. I'll take you right. You're probably have missed riding your beautiful Arabian horses. So he went down. He came down with me. He was a little bit hesitant about coming. I said, why don't you take a cinnabar, and I'll take a traveler, one of our horses, and I'll. And so. I showed him the saddle and the bridle. And so I was saddling up the horse, and I was cinching up the, you know, the, and I had the bridle on ready. And I saw him, and he had the bit, you know, the bit from the right, up over the top of the head of the horse, trying to put it on. And he had the strap that goes up here, and then around the horse. Suddenly it dawned on me, something's not right about all this. Well, to make a long story short, he was actually grooming the horses.
Oh.
Just to get my attention to them. And so I remember him telling me a parish that he was from, so I came right out. I was so, just, it just scared me. It was just such a spooky thing. I came up and I got on the phone and I called this priest that he mentioned in his little parish. I told him who he was. He was an Irish, remember, he had an Irish brogue. He, hello, Father, he says, oh, that's old Joe Pride. Pay no attention. He's a homeless man. He doesn't have much of anything. He lives in a homeless shelter here. Pay no attention to him. And I said, pay no attention to him. He's made himself. So I went into Abbot Conrad and I said to him, I said, do you realize this guy is a phony? I said, he's been dispensing medication to the students. And Conrad said, oh, don't say a word about it. And he was actually, he even got himself a class that he was teaching. I can't tell you what he was teaching. But he was, so I remember going to the door of the classroom and telling him, I said, Joe, you're a phony, and Abbot Conrad wants to see you immediately. He disappeared. We never saw a sight of him again.
Well, I thought they said the FBI arrested him here, though, no? The FBI arrested him. I thought it was here at St. Martin's, no?
That you're thinking about the other...
Oh, there's another one! Yeah. Oh, no.
Did you ever give the first imposter his $6 back?
Who was that?
Did you give him his $6 back?
No. I didn't. By that time, I thought, why is he? This is this multimillionaire who is a doctor and the head of the medical center. Why is he asking for the $6? I couldn't believe it. but he just disappeared, and we never ever. And I really felt, because of what damage he did, I was insisting on Abbot Conrad to inform the police about him. Mm-hmm. And don't send me a scandal. Don't, you know, that old business about not saying anything because you don't want scandal come to the school. Mm-hmm. I was mad at that for a long, long time. But the other one was... was the one who was here, I think, right before I came, and he was, what was his name? I remember he was on Johnny Carson, or after he left here. But he could do almost anything. He was doing surgeries when he was in the Navy. He was taking people's appendix out. I remember the story that he pulled the teeth of several of the monks. He was supposedly a very talented person. And what he would do is that he would somehow manage to get medical licenses off the graves of, you know, you'd find somebody that's deceased, then he'd call for their medical, and so he had all the records that he needed. But I remember the story about his, he taught French, and I think Dr. French, I think they used to call him. He taught French. He also taught literature and other languages. But he was also involved with the high school athletic program. And I heard that one of the monks was telling me that he literally had to fly our high school football team over to Yakima. Mm-hmm. And he... went into Olympia. The night before, he read how to fly a plane. He got in there. He was able to fly that plane. He got the students on the plane, flew them over to Yakima for their football game, flew them back. I mean, he was amazing what he could do. Do you remember, Genevieve, what his name was?
I think it was Demara. Or
Demara.
His real name was Demara.
That's it. Yeah. And so he was a monk here. He was a candidate, and so we thought this is amazing, all these things he could do. But I remember one night being told that he was serving the coffee, and we had a visiting abbot from some abbey back in Chicago or the East Coast, and he was sitting there, and he was looking at this monk with his black hat on a serving. And after dinner, he said to Edward Rayfield, who was that monk? He was at our abbey, and I think this guy is a phony. He goes from abbey to abbey to abbey. And sure enough, they called him. They called the Lacey sheriff. The sheriff came up, and Edward Rayfield called him into his office, and the sheriff was behind the door. He said, okay, no fight. Yeah, I've been. Apparently, it's a very likable person, and with such talents and gifts, you can imagine you could actually fly an airplane just reading the book the night before, pulling people's teeth out, just incredible. My only association with him is that I ended up with his desk when I was a novice. I remember pulling around. Had all these cards, you know, with all of his official sort of names. I think I still have one or two of his cards somewhere. They made a movie, The Great Imposter is the name of the movie, and I think Tony Curtis, the actor, played the role of Damaris. But I did see him later, years later, on Johnny Carson or some TV program, they're asking him about, and he just seemed to go from one place, the next job or the next profession, but highly, highly gifted and talented, kind of a waste of it.
You have to go to Mass, yes?
Yes.
Mass
is at 5.
Oh, it's all the time. No, we had Mass this morning.
Oh, okay.
We had Mass at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Okay.
So I'll be happy to answer any more questions you might have, or any other.
Any questions from the? You've been video streamed.
Yeah.
Do you know that? So people are watching all over, watching you.
We've had almost 700 views.
700 people have viewed you talking today.
Oh, you're kidding.
No.
No,
say hi. Say hi to everyone.
Say hi.
That's what Kevin's doing right here.
Yeah.
Social media.
Wave. He needs a waiver.
You're famous.
Many people are sending their love. They want
to
They love hearing your voice.
That's
nice.
Thank you. But as I say, there's so many stories you can have. Even that. One of the funniest stories, when I was living in the dormitory, I was director of residence at the time, and I remember one night, I was living on the second floor of Barron Hall, and one of the, I used to leave my door open, just so if the students saw the door open, they wouldn't be making so much noise and racket in the hallway. So I remember one evening, I was sitting there reading, and all of a sudden, a student came in from Hawaii, and all of a sudden he had this awful, terrifying, he had a kind of a seizure, and he collapsed on the right on the floor. I immediately called 911, and the medics came out here, and by that time he was kind of coming to. And I said, what in the world happened? He says, oh, he said, when I came into your room, I was sitting in front of the window, and it just started to snow. And it was the first time he had seen snow.
Oh.
So he stood up, and the top of the door jam was metal, and he knocked himself out. Oh.
That's trying
to explain to the medic, sorry. I thought the poor fellow had some sort of seizure. So, yeah, that was... Oh, God. it's an amazing experience living in the residence hall with the students, because there's no end to what they're up to. Another time in Barron Hall, we had when you dust mop the floor, they would have this, you put the dust mop over this.
Oh, it would suck it in, yeah.
This suction thing. And so I heard all this racket out in the hallway, and what they were having races. What they would do, they would put toilet paper at one end, and then they would put the, they would cut it the length of the hallway, and then they would turn that thing on, and they would race to see if you could
beat the
toilet paper. And the one who got there before the toilet paper was consumed got the prize. It's a big activity on the toilet paper races. Another time they brought, this is when we still have the farm, they brought up some pigs to the top floor, and they literally greased the pig. I don't know if you're having a greased pig race, and they were chasing those poor little piglets down the hallway. And of course you couldn't grab them because they were squealing, they were so greased. Another time, they brought up a cow, and then I remember coming out of the hallway and hearing this mooing and manure all over the no student in sight, but apparently cows can go up steps. So you can imagine the nightmare we had getting the cow out of that. At that point, I had enough of it. I just thought, so anyway, I called several companies, see if they can, could you remove a cow on the third floor of Barron Hall? So they got the poor cow out of there. Another interesting thing about the, I remember the phone company, we used to have a public phone at the end of each hallway on every floor of Barron Hall. And all these phone calls were being made, but the phone people came out and said that somebody's actually stealing money out of the box, the phone box. I said, how can that be? Again, next month it came out, there was numerous phone calls made, a lot of them to the East Coast, because we had a lot of East Coast students at that time, from Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, that couldn't get into the schools in New York, so that's why we have this great influx of East Coasters. So it was amazing how is it somebody stealing the money? And they even changed the box, the phone company changed the box. It was coming from just one phone, I think, on my floor, and they changed it. Still, the money was missing from all the phone calls. Well, to make a long story short, what happened, I noticed the student had recorded on his little recorder the sound of a nickel, a quarter, ding, boom, ding, but he turned it on, and that let his phone go through.
Oh.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, it sounded like
he made the original call, but it was $3 to New York, so he dropped in all the quarters, and ding, dong, ding, dong. But then he just recorded it. And so he wasn't really stealing money. So when I confronted him about it, he said, brother, what's the big deal? You know, I mean, I wasn't hurting anybody. You know, he's got a...
Mm-hmm. You write them down, and we'll have you back again.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that would be fun. Write down stories that you didn't tell us, and then we
and
can
then
do it again.
Back.
I'll do a second video.
Yeah, just stories.
Yeah, stories from Killian.
Like, we'll do a second video that's just stories.
Yeah. Oh, that'd be great.
That would be lovely.
Abigail is good for remembering things. Sometimes I forget them, but I'll get together with him and ask him if he has any.
Maybe we should have the two of you go back and forth. That would be nice, don't you think?
Oh, yeah, it was great. We were out at the lodge one night, and it was both of them, and they were just hilarious.
We used to have our office, so we say our prayers, on top of the laundry building. It was the worst place to have it because we had the candle. We used to make our own candle. We had this candle dipping program that I was in charge of the candles. And I think and then Neil had to work in the laundry, but then we'd have to go there at 5 in the evening for our evening prayer. And it was like walking into an oven. This is before any air conditioning was even thought of. But I remember I was so hot that I was sort of leading. I had the reading that night, and it was from, I forget what passage it was from, but it had the words in it. And the Lord God said, "You are made for immortality. You will live forever. Immortality is your call. Immortality, be immortal, living." And so I remember I was up there, and I was—I think I was still still a novice. I was so nervous reading in public, and so I started out, and so immorality. Immorality is your. And Father Clement, who was the novice pastor, was ringing the bell for me to stop. Bing. And I kept going on and on. Immorality, called to be immoral. Finally, he got up and he shook and he said, "The word is immortality."
So, can you tell us again how you picked your name?
Oh, yeah. I think this is still true today, that whenever, let's say, if any a young person coming to the monastery to become a monk, we have to give up our name. We give up our clothes, as it were, and put on new clothes. We also have our head shaven, cut, and so little things. But one of the things that we have to choose a new name. And the tradition is when you turn in three names to the abbot, other than your own, and he would normally give you the first choice. That was always the way. So I remember when I came and I went through the novitiate. I started the novitiate, and then the day that I was to be invested as a monk, I came up to turn in my three names to Abbot. Who was the abbot at that time. And the names that I had on my list was Sean, which my name is John, or Jack. I went by Jack all my life. I was born John. And so I put the Gaelic for John to Sean, S-E-A-N. And then the second choice was Kevin. So there was a group of monks outside the back door smoking, and I was going up to the Abbot Raphael's office, which was just down the hall here. And they say, "Hey, show us your name, show us your name." So I showed them. You have to have three names. They said, just put anything down on the third, and he'll always give you your first choice. So I ran back down to my room, because I was living in where is now the guest house and the counseling center. Mm-hmm. That's where the brothers live. And so I went down to under, and the book was opened up to the case, and because you had to give a feast day with it. So I said, Killian, K-I-L-I-A-N, feast, August, or July the 8th. So I wrote that down and went back up and turned it in. Well, the next morning at the Mass, and then when I was invested, I remember him saying, "Henceforth in life, you will always be known as Brother Killian." So I said, So we went out in the porch, and then my parents and my brothers and sisters were there at the ceremony, and we only had like 10 minutes to visit with them. Then they had to be gone. I couldn't see them for a year during the novitiate. So I went out and I said, "Oh, Abbot, why did you give me, what is that name you gave me, Killian?" I said, "What happened to me?" He said, "Well, I never heard of a saint seen." That's not seen. That was the gift for John. Well, anyway, we have Kevin already in the house, and he's on a leave of absence. So don't even try to add. Well, the interesting thing was when I went out to say goodbye to my parents, my mother says in her wonderful Irish brogue, "Oh, God, we love you. You selected the patron of our village in Ireland, St. Julian." I said, "Oh, yeah, I..." I hadn't realized that. And years later, when I was in school, Linda, I went back to my mom and dad's village, and sure enough, the St. Killian's well is still at the bottom of the street.
Yeah.
And apparently, there were several cures from the water of the well. I remember one of the old timers said, "Oh, I remember a woman had a child, and the child was blind, and she bathed the child in the water of St. Killian's well, and be able to see again." So anyway, I've been Killian ever since.
That's great. That's great. Well, thank you.
I enjoyed it very much.
July 8th, then. Your feast day, right? Your feast day is July 8th?
Yeah.
All right.